am Dr. Carey Hemmelgarn. I want to introduce you guys to our third module in our toxicology course. This is going to be on a review of poisonous plants. There are many plants that can be found inside the home and outside that can be toxic to pets. If possible exposure, the best resource for considering whether a plant is toxic or not is our ASPCA plant toxin list. This source can provide pictures and is the most comprehensive list of toxicities and how to treat them. We're going to go through some of the more common toxic plants that you may encounter in your veterinary clinic. Lilies, unfortunately, are the most classic toxic plant. It's definitely seasonal, especially around Easter time. It's a very common toxicity that we see. This includes the Lilium and the Hemerocallis species, and they fall into the Liliacea family. They are toxic to cats, and they're not toxic to dogs and horses, oddly. The toxic principle is unfortunately unknown, but that we know that all parts of the plant are toxic to cats. Lilies are nephrotoxic in cats. If cats have pollen on their face or their paws, they should be bathed to remove toxin to prevent re-exposure or for them to continue to clean themselves and re-ingest the pollen. If they could have eaten a piece of the plant, emesis should be induced. Toxicity can be seen within hours of ingestion. The most classic clinical signs of lily toxicity in a cat are going to be vomiting, hypersalivation, anorexia, depression. Those are going to be your most common ones. The initial management of lily toxicity includes obtaining a baseline renal value, placing an IV catheter, starting IV diuresis, and monitoring kidney values every 24 hours for the first 72 hours post-exposure. If at any point we notice that their kidney values are rising or that they're not making adequate urine, transferring them to a facility that has hemodialysis capabilities is going to be the best recommended option for that patient. The prognosis is better if treatment is initiated immediately before they're noted to be azotemic or not making adequate amounts of urine. Unfortunately, if they become azotemic or they're not making urine, their ability to recover from this is poor. The next plant we're going to talk about is sago palm toxicity. This unfortunately has been more prevalent in the recent years due to them appearing in grocery stores and being brought into homes where previously they were only outside and not necessarily being exposed to our pets. Cycads, also known as sago palms, are toxic to people, dogs, cats, and horses. There's been many cases of sago palm toxicity in people and livestock that have eaten these plants inadvertently. Chronic exposure to Cycad products has been linked to development of amyotrophic lateral sclerosis and Parkinson dementia complex in people. Mainly this is seen in subtropic regions where these plants are common and they're more likely to ingest them. There are three toxins in the Cycad plant. That's going to be our azoxyglycosides with a toxic metabolite of methyl azo oxymethanol. The other one, our second one, is going to be our B-methylamino-L-amine, or BMAA, and the third is an unidentified high molecular weight compound. The seeds contain the highest concentration of the toxins, but they can be seen throughout their entire plant. The toxicity is most commonly seen in spring and summer, but could be year-round if these plants live within the home. The most common clinical signs can occur as early as 15 minutes after ingestion and up to 3 days after potential exposure, so a very wide range of time frame. The most common clinical signs that we're going to see initially are going to be severe gastrointestinal signs. It's going to be vomiting, diarrhea, abdominal pain, and in many cases you'll notice either melena or hematochezia with pretty profound signs, and so these pets come in very, very sick and showing very severe GI signs as their first signs. As the disease progresses, signs of liver failure can be present, including icterus or jaundice. They can have coagulopathies, neurologic signs. Blood work on these patients will show elevations of their liver values, their coagulation, thrombocytopenia, low cholesterol, hypoglycemia, and hypoalbuminemia, all signs of synthetic liver failure. Unfortunately, there's no definitive testing available, but only based off of presumptive exposure. So if you have it in your house and that pet is showing those signs and there's a possibility of exposure, that's the only way for us really to know. Decontamination is warranted if early presentation after ingestion, that can include inducing emesis or gastric lavage, is a consideration if there's a high level that they could have ingested that. Activated charcoal can be considered due to the fact that sacopum is a toxicity that has enterohepatic recirculation, and that's something that can be helpful to prevent reaccumulation of that toxin. Treatment is reliant on treating clinical signs with IV fluids, anti-nausea medications, gastroprotectants, liver protected medications such as N-acetylcysteine injectably or denamarin as an oral medication to help with the liver. If we're seeing signs of coagulopathies, then plasma transfusions, vitamin K1 to help, antibiotics to prevent bacterial translocation. And the prognosis is guarded depending on clinical signs and the response to treatment. Some papers have described in dogs a survival of about 50% once they start showing clinical signs. The next plant we're going to talk about is the rhododendron. It's also known as rose bay or azalea. It's toxic to cats, dogs, livestock, and horses. Rhododendron belongs to the ericaceae family, and the toxic component of this plant is the granotoxin. Such as the lily, the rhododendron, all parts of the plant are toxic and have contained that toxin, the granotoxin. As with lilies, the same with rhododendrons, all parts of the plant contain the toxin, the granotoxin, and toxicity can be seen with ingestion as little as 0.2% of the patient's body weight. Initial clinical signs mainly are located to our gastrointestinal tract with vomiting, diarrhea, inappetence, hypersalivation, and abdominal pain. In advanced cases, we can also see neurologic and muscular skeletal signs for the fact that the granotoxin interferes with muscle and nerve function. Cardiac problems can be noted due to the cardiac muscle interference and lead to cardiac muscle weakness. Unfortunately, treatment is mainly supportive. There's no antidote for this plant toxicity. The prognosis is highly dependent on the severity of clinical signs. So with just GI signs, it's a very good prognosis. But if you're starting to know neurologic or cardiac signs, the prognosis is poor. Our next plant we're going to talk about is oleander. Oleander is also known as rose bay or rose laurel, and it's toxic to dogs, cats, livestock, and horses. The toxic principle found in oleander is cardiac glycosides. The glycosides can be found in all parts of the plant. Oddly, the red flowered versions are more toxic than the white flowers versions of oleander. The cardiac glycosides inhibit the cellular membrane sodium-potassium, the sodium-potassium ATPase enzyme system pump. That causes depletion of intracellular potassium and increases serum potassium. The high serum potassium causes bradycardia and can eventually lead to full atrial standstill and death. Clinical signs post-ingestion include vomiting, arrhythmias, weakness, collapse, dyspnea, mydriasis or very dilated pupils, and confirmatory diagnosis would be via detection of the cardiac glycosides in the serum or urine, but is not a routine bedside test that we can provide. Treatment includes emesis if ingestion has been recent, activated charcoal to slow any further absorption in their system. If hyperkalemia is noted on initial blood work, then treatment with IV fluids, albuterol inhalers, dextrose, insulin, and supportive care are recommended. Calcium gluconate, which is something we commonly will use to treat hyperkalemia in some patients, should be avoided as this can potentiate the cardiac glycosides. Treatment with digoxin-specific antibodies has been effective in humans with oleander toxicity. It's not something that we commonly use in veterinary medicine, but it could be considered if you have a massive toxicity. Our next toxicity plant we're going to talk about is castor bean. Castor bean plants are also known as castor oil plants, hygrelia, palma christi, mole bean plant, and the African wonder tree. They're toxic to animals and humans. The toxic chemical in this plant is ricinolytic acid or ricin. Ricin is found in the highest concentration in the seeds. ricin is absorbed from the intestinal tract, metabolized in the liver, and afterwards it's absorbed into the cells and inhibits ribosomal protein synthesis. Organ systems involved include the gastrointestinal tract, muscle weakness, cardiovascular collapse, liver failure, and multi-organ dysfunction syndrome. Treatment involves early decontamination if ingestion has been recent, activated charcoal administration, and supportive therapy with IV fluids, anti-nausea medications, GI support. Interesting, vitamin C therapy has been shown to be helpful when treating ricin toxicity in people and maybe something to consider in veterinary patients if massive ingestion. The next plant we're going to talk about is the calancho. The calancho is also known as the mother-in-law plant, devil's backbone, chandelier plant, and mother of millions. Calanchi, like oleander, contains cardiac glycosides as the toxic principle. Toxicity is mainly in the summer months as the flowers contain the highest concentration of the cardiac glycosides compared with the other months. So interesting enough, it really is just a toxicity that we see in the summer. And that in the other months, the highest toxicity is seen in the stems and leaves, but they don't commonly get ingested with just the stems and leaves. The glycosides present in calanchi are a group of bufonamide compounds, including bryotoxins, bryoflins, and bergolins. These compounds work similar to digitalis and inhibit the sodium-potassium ATPase enzyme system. They push potassium out of cells into the serum and cause severe hyperkalemia. The initial clinical signs after ingestion are, again, gastrointestinal signs, but as time progresses, we'll see progressive weakness, bradycardia, and cardiovascular collapse. It has been noted that some dogs that get into this can have neurologic signs, but this is seen more commonly in livestock that are chronically exposed to this and not necessarily an acute exposure. There's no definitive test for this plant toxicity, similar as many of the plants. We don't have a bedside test for it, but it is something sending out urine or blood levels could be potentially helpful. This is something that's done in livestock testing, not commonly in small animals. Decontamination is important with this plant. And treatment is supportive for the GI signs with IV fluids, anti-nausea medications, and if hyperkalemia is present or if arrhythmias are present, then treatment would include IV fluids, albuterol, dextrose insulin, and again, if you have the availability for the digoxin-specific antibodies, this is something that could be used for this toxicity. The next plant is the yew plant. Yew is also known as the Japanese yew. The toxic principle is taxine in this, which falls into a group of toxic alkaloids. All parts of the green plant are toxic. The most toxic is the leaves in the winter. Dried leaves can also cause toxicity, and many clinical signs can be seen, including gastrointestinal signs, muscle tremors, ataxia, cardiovascular signs, bradycardia, seizures, dyspnea. All of those are things we can see with yew toxicity. Yew toxicity can be toxic based off of the severity of clinical signs. So if they're very mild signs, then the prognosis would be good. But if they are severe signs, it can be something that can be fatal. Treatment is based off of supportive care, based off of your clinical signs. If bradycardia is present, then giving a dose of atropine would be useful. And unfortunately, again, there's no diagnostic test that can confirm a definitive diagnosis in a bedside manner. The next plant we're going to talk about is tulips. Tulips can be toxic to dogs and cats. The toxins are mainly located in the bulb, which is less likely to be ingested, but the toxins are called tulipan A and tulipan B. Clinical signs of toxicity include gastrointestinal signs such as vomiting, diarrhea, inappetence, and hypersalivation. The signs are usually pretty minimal, but treatment is based off of supportive care. The poinsettia. So poinsettias are toxic to dogs and cats. The plant contains an irritating sap that it causes irritation in the mouth and the stomach when it's ingested. It's usually very mild GI signs, and treatment is mainly just treating them for anti-nausea medications, IV or sub-Q fluids if they're dehydrated. The next plant we're going to talk about is aloe vera. Aloe vera plants are in the family of the Liliaceae and can be toxic to dogs and cats. The two toxic substances in the plants are saponins and anthraquinones. Clinical signs usually are vomiting, diarrhea, lethargy, and they usually tend to be very mild signs, and the treatment is supportive, managing them for their GI signs and if dehydration is present, and the prognosis is usually very good with supportive care. Thank you so much for joining us.